There we go. Welcome to T3G Tangents. This is Panels on Pages. Today, welcome, Lord Rampant Hump, to the broadcast. This is Panels on Pages. This is where we talk comic books and all things comic book related. Today is going to be a very, I'm not going to say very, very short one, but it's going to be a shorter one than normal. We're only going to talk about one book, and we're going to kind of branch off of that. Because I am doing a little special extra broadcast tonight with the creator of a book. So I've got a very special guest for a later show. So I wanted to kind of keep this one short and sweet. This is a book that I picked up. We're discussing Warren Ellis's Aetheric Mechanics. This is a book that I picked up at a Half Price Books, which is a used bookstore around here. This is the version I have, the black and white cover. That's very hard to see. Wow, the white balance on this is terrible. I'm also blue for some reason. I've never understood that for this angle. I don't know what it is. But this is a very fantastic book in that this is the convention version color. I don't like it because the inside is black and white, and I really like the overall aesthetic of the cover being black and white. Apparat is an imprint of Avatar Press, where Warren Ellis did a lot of really, really cool books, but a lot of like kind of unsung heroes like this book. I think this is kind of a really low-key book that most people don't talk about, most people don't know. So the premise, the thing it's trying to sell you, and I obviously, I'm hinting at that it's not that, and I really don't want to give it away. It's a short read. It's a very, very thin book. I mean, it's like, what, does it have page numbers? No. I mean, if it's 200, hold on. There's a way to know this. 52 pages in total, and that's with like the extra covers and stuff. If you want to read it, I think you should read it because I think it's a great story. The cool thing about this is it's clearly set in some sort of steampunk-ish 1900s London. You follow this character, Dr. Robert Watcham. He's coming home from the front. He's kind of lamenting on the state of things, flying machines and all this kind of crazy stuff that's happening. And he goes home to a detective, and this is, I think, the greatest moment. He says, "I trust your wound no longer bothers you unduly." He says, I somehow doubt news of my accident reached London. Go on, I know you're dying too." And then he gives him the reason why he knows, and I'm like, oh, it's Sherlock Watson, and Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson. Hey, one can't speak. I'm like, it's clearly like Watson and Holmes. Like that's what it is. But it's weird because like, why wouldn't you? Because like, they're public domain characters. It's clearly a different setting. I mean, there's talk of, you know, defending the front and Mars and all this kind of crazy stuff. So I'm like, this is like an alternate, fantastical history, and I don't understand why we're even dealing with it's a different name. Because what do they call him? His name is so weird. It's like Saxton something. Sax Raker. Oh yeah, Saxamundham is his full name. Sax Raker is Sherlock Holmes. And I just don't understand it. I don't understand it. You know, I'm reading it. I'm like, why is this happening? Now, the thing about it is, I can't, like I said, I really don't want to give it away. I can't tell you why. But it is a really good reason. It's a very, very interesting. The story that builds, and this is why I wanted to pull this one specifically. I have a couple other books I was going to talk about, but like I said, I've got a different kind of approach to this that I want to do. I think Warren Ellis is one of the greatest modern writers we have. I think he has written some of the most interesting stories. I think he's written some of the best concepts and the best approaches to a lot of really kind of touchy subjects, especially for their time. The thing that comes to mind is authority, and we'll get to that because that's in the A's. We'll be getting to that in the next few weeks for sure. But in the Authority, starting in Stormwatch, but mostly in the Authority, he had a... There's really no other way to say this. He had a gay Batman and Superman. And it worked, like, so well, that it's hard to think about them not being that. It's hard, not Batman and Superman. He had characters Midnighter and Apollo. But it's hard to think about that book being done any other way, because it's just such a key element of it that, and it's not done in some sort of like weird flashy way. It's just like part of their daily life. These like little romantic moments, like talking about killing people, you know, and because these guys are murderers, the Authority are the murderous bastards, realistically, but. It's just these moments where they talk to each other in these, like, sweet, sweet nothings during the middle of, like, a super violent bloody fight. So it's just the nuance of how he writes is really interesting to me, and I think it's really, it's a really attractive way of writing. It pulls me into a story every time. I've read this book before, and as soon as I started reading it, and I was like, oh, I really, like, I know the outcome, but... I'm into it. I'm in already, and I'm like, I'm trying to pull all these little things. They pull a case, you know, as Holmes and Watson are wont to do. And Watson. I always forget his damn name in the book because I always want to call him just Watson. Watch him. Right? Yeah. Whatever. He goes upstairs and he has this flashback of this giant robot attacking London or wherever he was stationed. It may not have been London. And it's just this like ridiculous moment in a book that's essentially Holmes and Watson just in crazy settings. But it's just this like Royal British Navy versus giant steampunk robot. Things that most people do not think of. Things that most writers do not think of. I think that's another strength of Warren Ellis, is that he pulls from everything. So the things that come up in his books especially, most people don't do. Most people don't write the way he does. So it's just very interesting. I also think the art choice for this was perfect. It's like a melancholy indie book feel. Written by a major name. Who's the artist? Always forget. Yep, nope, not gonna try to pronounce that. Oh. There we go. The artist is that. I can't pronounce that. Gianluca is probably the first, but nope, not really going to try the last one. It's hella Italian, and I'm not going to do it, and I'm not going to butcher it. but I'd be interested to know what else he's done. Let's see. Okay, so he's got his own little website. He's got his own book, Ignition City. Very cool. Yeah, so he's been working. He's been putting in some work around the comic book space. I really thoroughly enjoy this book. I think it's an incredible kind of cheeky look at the way we treat things, the way we treat some fictional properties and some ideas. There's a lot of reference to kind of classic home stories. When he meets him, he says, "Do you remember God's Falls?" And that's for the Sherlock Holmes fans. That's the Reichenbach Falls. I can't believe I remembered that. First of all, that's the Reichenbach Falls story. It's kind of I want to say that was the last book. That, and now I'm going to not remember his damn name. It's the last book the original author wrote. Oh, it really bothers me that I don't remember. I have the volume upstairs. Welcome, General Aaron, to the broadcast. We're discussing Warren Ellis's Aetheric Mechanics. Reichenbach Falls was the last story of Holmes before the original author died. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Knew it was going to come to me. It's the last story he wrote, and it's where Sherlock Holmes died. Obviously, since then, the Sherlock Holmes brand has evolved, and, you know, he didn't die, came back, etc. There's been, I think there are to this day, new books being written in the series of Sherlock Holmes. That's a very interesting, like, aside to me to begin with. But it's just these, like, little throwbacks, because as soon as he shows up, he says, I've even got the title for you. They go on the, he writes stories about the cases and all that stuff. It's very interesting to me because he says, I even have the title for you, Sax Raker and the Case of the Man Who Wasn't There. And I actually think that might have been one of the original stories. I think that was the first. If you watch the new series with Cumberbatch, I think that's actually one of those. I think that's the first episode. Sherlock Holmes and the Case of the Man. Let me see. There's a man who disappeared. Something about the disappearing man. Because the disappearing man, something like that. Regardless. So it's similar. But as soon as I read that, I was like, oh, that might be that first storyline from the TV show, TV series, and it kind of is. Again, I really don't want to give it away because this is to me like a classic Holmesian twist. It you don't see it coming, and then so like there's a twist, and then there's like an additional twist, and that's my favorite kind of writing. My favorite kind of writing is where you do not know what's about to happen. You just genuinely have no clue, and I think in this situation, you absolutely have no idea about what's happening. You follow it along, you're like, all right, I'm with you, and then it takes a turn, and you're like, ah, okay, so that's what's going on, cool. And then you kind of think ahead, and you're like, this is how it's going to resolve itself, but it doesn't. And then it takes another turn, and then you're just like, oh, man. One of my favorite books that I read that was just like that was, oddly enough, James Patterson's First to Die. Which, like, really sold me on that entire series, because the last probably 10 chapters of the book, every time I finished a chapter, I was just blown away, and I needed to read the next one, because I thought it was going to go this way, then it went this way, and then it just kept pivoting, and by the end, I had no clue what was going on. Absolutely no clue. And that's kind of what you get here. Like I said, you know, they catch this case, they go after it, and there's just very, I love the transition. He takes the time to clean himself off, like washes the war off of himself, and goes out into polite society, and I love how he says, what would you have me know of your war? And having just had that flashback to that giant robot, and clearly like a PTSD episode, it's one of those things that it's kind of like everyday questions, right? People come back from being out, deployed, whatever, and people ask them, like, oh, what was it like? It's fucking a war. Like, what do you mean, what was it like? Like, welcome, BJ, how you doing today? So it's just very interesting. Again, it's the little nuanced stuff that just really brings out the book and the characters. Like I said, I'm only going to go so far because I don't want to give away the story. But it's just, again, very, very awesome Holmesian. I am. Thank you very much. Very awesome Holmesian moments. Like, pray, silence, I'm thinking. And that to me is like, Holmes has always been a character that I've absolutely loved, just because at the end of the day, he's smarter than you. He knows it. He makes sure that you know it. And no matter what happens, he knew it was going to happen. I always thought, like, the first time, and this was probably grade school, the first time I read a home story, I thought he was the most condescending jerk on the planet. You get to the end and he's like, "Wow, elementary, my dear Watson," and goes down the list of things, like, kind of a, "How could you miss this?" And I'm just like, "Wow, this guy's a jerk." This guy, but then at the same time, I'm like, "How could they miss that?" Like, so it's, he's right, but this is the way he goes about it. He's a jerk. He's a complete jerk. There's just no way around that. See, but then this is kind of cool because, again, the little details, he goes through, he looks at all the things that you would see Holmes do. And I love that in this kind of micro moment, it takes away from the enormity of the premise, this steampunk universe with flying machines and Mars fronts and all these things. It's just this finite moment of, there's a dead body, we're examining it. And I think this to me is kind of like the best way stories are told. I think there was a great TV series, I think it was called Almost Human. That might be correct. The guy who played McCoy in the new Star Trek movies. The guy who played Dredd. I can't think of his name for some reason. He was the main dude. He had, his partner was a robot, android. I don't remember what they called them. But it was these, like, super huge concepts, you know, like full cybernetic life and crazy, like, memory devices and all this stuff. But at the end of the day, it really, really nuanced level, it was just a cop story. And, like, the best parts of it were him just investigating stuff, him just finding out, you know, the reason something happened and, you know, finding a murderer. Like, at the end of the day, I think the larger components, like the grand scope of stuff, has to just influence the story. The story has to be the most important piece. So, like, this being at its core a Holmes and Watson story, regardless of the, like, ridiculous giant robots and all the space travel and stuff, at the end of the day, Holmes is Holmes, Watson is Watson, and that's what the story's about. And, like, even the guns, and it's funny because it's a steampunk world, even the guns and, like, the technology is very much 1900s, but, like, again, there's flying vehicles outside. There are flying ships and I think that's a giant wing. Like, there's attacks from the sky, all sorts of stuff. It's just very interesting to me how different writers approach this kind of stuff. Because a lot of people try this out. A lot of people take, like, classic, you know, 1800s, 1900s, even modern day, and then just propel the technology ahead. And it's very interesting to see how some writers rely then heavily on that technology, and, like, that's what the story's about. Like, whatever is happening, but the story's about that technology. It's like, if it's a murder case, it's about, like, all the fancy ways that they're going to find the murderer. It's not about the investigative work. It's not about the people. It's about, oh, pull up this technology and check out this thing. And here's this robot and here's this other thing. Whereas the flip side of that is, I think, the better way to do it personally, is the focus on the characters. Because I think that's, at the end of the day, without the characters, you can have all the cool tech on the planet, but, like, without something to use it, without somebody to drive that story, there's just nothing. It's just boring. Like, it's cool to come up with crazy stuff. Like, again, you have this macro shot of, they walk into this room, a lot of crazy technology, and then the next shot is people. And again, between all of this, I mean, there's been pages at this point where there's been no mention of this grander technology. Like, right there, you have a flying car. And then we're inside, we're talking to people, and the house is very 1907 England. Everything is 1907 England, just like those little extra details. Like, crazy cars. Like, mad jets shooting bombs at them. And it just adds to the story, I think. It's kind of what I think Transformers tries to accomplish. Transformers, I think, tries to put us in the Sam Witwicky seat. in the, I don't know his name, but Mark Wahlberg's seat. they try to put, that's us, right? That's us, just people dealing with giant robots fighting. And that's kind of what we're having to deal with. Like, it's, but I think Transformers fails at that. I think Transformers' most entertaining stuff is definitely the giant robots fighting. I think the people in the Transformers movies, at least, I think the shows have done it a little bit better, but I think mostly because they've reduced the impact of the humans. Welcome, Elliot. I think the focus on people above the grander technological or situational story, I think, is the better way to approach things. Like I said, I think Transformers is an excellent kind of counterexample to this. Is it's not like Transformers movies are not great movies. They're just not. Thanks for the share, Elliot. Thanks. Transformers movies are not great movies. They're entertaining as heck. I'm always down to watch a Transformers movie. I watched the first one probably 10 times. I've watched the what's it called? The commentary 3 or 4 times. I'm a fan of the movies, but they're not great films. I don't watch them for the human drama or the human story. It's very much just, meh. Let's watch some giant robots fighting on screen. That's really what we want to see. I don't really care if Sam Witwicky is not liked at school. I really don't care. and I think for the most part, and at least in the first movie, they treated Sam Witwicky as a plot device. It was, you have the glasses, which have the map. And then it's really like these little, like, but the problem then was that they did try to build him, oh, like, there's this romantic thing with the other girl, and like, nah, it's, you can just have the glasses that have the map, and we can move on with the robot stuff. I'm okay with that. I think a lot of creators try to ground stuff when it doesn't need to be, and go super lofty when they should ground stuff. Thanks for the share, VJ. I think it's very interesting to see how creators and writers approach different stories. Welcome, Blaster. I think it's very interesting to see how people approach different stories, because having, I think, the human component and having that be the driving force of a story, I think a Transformer story, since I keep using that example, I think a Transformer story would be very, very difficult to do strictly from the point of the humans. I think having the Transformers as just the MacGuffins, the story elements, I think it doesn't work because they have their own personalities. And I think that's where the conflict for me comes in. Transformers have their own personalities. Transformers have their own stories. So to try to, like, shoehorn in human stories between all that, it doesn't work. Whereas in something like this, this is a Holmes-Watson story that happens to have flying cars and crazy technology, as opposed to if this was about, you know, 25th century robots, and then also trying to shove in Watson and Holmes. Like, if the story is about, although one of the best things on the planet, and I will say this without reservation, share this right now. And it's actually, ironically enough, I'm gonna share the intro. We're gonna pause it. We're gonna window capture this. The best kind of interesting out there adaptation. Yeah, so this is basically Sherlock Holmes with flying cars, also with like mad giant robots. But I think a really interesting kind of different out there take on Sherlock Holmes was, there we go. Oh, I'm gonna put my headphones on.
Sherlock Holmes. Bring Sherlock Holmes back to life. Back to life.
It's elementary, my dear Watson.
Sherlock Holmes in the 22nd century. Sherlock Holmes in the 22nd century.
You can't hear me. Are we doing this again? This hears me. Oh, that was too loud. I see what you're saying. So that was to me one of the coolest like really out there takes on Sherlock Holmes, is because it same kind of premise, like, hey, we thought you died in the cartoon series. They were frozen. Moriarty and Holmes were both frozen. Holmes gets defrosted basically, and they bring him back, and he's helping. I think her name is also Lestrade. And then Watson's intellect and knowledge is placed inside of an android. He then puts a Watson mask on. And a big element of the story then becomes Watson accepting, or rather Holmes accepting Watson as Watson and not a robot. It's a really kind of, again, different take where, at the end of the day, it's still a Watson and Holmes story. You're just adding these fantastical, these like sci-fi elements to it. So I think that's what these two stories kind of compare really well, in that you're still, at the end of the day, doing more with the characters and more with the world building from that answer. You gives me cancer. Why? Why do you say that? I think it really does give credit to the creators of that show, because I think it's, again, it's just about the characters. It's not robots and science and crazy stuff. Oh, also Sherlock Holmes. It's very much Sherlock Holmes, the music, the whole trend. I mean, yeah, but it's from the late 90s. I mean, you saw the graphics. They were not great. No, it's that kind of stuff. You're young. You didn't live through it, man. That was the golden age. Modern cartoons are garbage. I said it. Take it to the bank. Modern cartoons are garbage. No one has any creativity. Everyone's just rehashing the same old stuff. I think I would like to see a good continuation of Mighty Max. But Mighty Max was such a tightly woven story that you couldn't do a sequel. You couldn't do a continuation. You'd have to remake it, and I feel like if they did, it would be trash. That's the problem I have with it. If you don't know Mighty Max, you should absolutely watch Mighty Max. Saw part of the new Ed and Eddie, and it's trash. I don't even know what that is. What Ed and Eddie? That's just too much air. Too much air sound. But that's what I'm saying. I think it's it was an amazing cartoon show. Amazing, you said. Amazing. You said amazing. Like, that's a big word. Amazing's a big word, friend. But anyway, I think this is an excellent Kids on the Block. The heck is Kids on the Block? See, I don't even know that. Kids on the Block? It's not a thing. It's not a thing. There's New Kids on the Block. That was a music group. I put that in quotes. I say was. I think they're actually still doing stuff. Kids Next Door. Okay, I thought that's what you meant. Kids Next Door. Candy. Candy's a very, very interesting, and that's the kind of thing. Like, I think that was kind of the last great story, the last great comic book or TV show. Because when did that start? 2002. Yeah, that was right at the back end of that. Because I think before this, you had like Recess, which I thought was a really, really good series. But I think after Adventure Time, I have so many things to say about Adventure Time. It's so weird. It's not for kids. And that's the thing. Adventure Time, if you're an adult and you like that stuff, perfectly fine. I don't care, whatever. It's a weird thing, and you can like your weird thing, and that's fine. But like, I'm talking cartoons for kids. I saw the new Spider-Man cartoon, and it is dreadful. It is ugly. It has literally no shadows except for one or two shots here and there, and it bothers me. Dexter's Laboratory is absolutely for kids. What are you talking about? It has some jokes. Yeah, it has some very interesting jokes, I'm sure. All right, let's see. Dexter's Laboratory. I'm pretty sure. Animated series. I'm trying to see what the... It says like a target audience. Nah, man, that's definitely a kid's series. Yeah, it's Hanna-Barbera. Come on, it's Hanna-Barbera. They're not going to not make stuff for kids. But what you meant is what? What is it that you meant, Blaster? Too much for the kids. See, I don't think that's true. I don't think that's true at all. I think it's kind of like SpongeBob. I think it's very much, if you look at something like Gargoyles, which I thought was a super duper dark series. When I originally watched it, I didn't think it was that dark. I just thought it was, I was taking the surface lessons and the surface ideas like loyalty, friendship, family, that kind of stuff. But when you actually, if you actually watch Gargoyles as an adult, Gargoyles is an incredibly dark series about backstabbing and hate and racism and just a whole lot of really dark stuff and like tough, like harsh subjects. So I think that's the kind of show that holds up. If you look at the original X-Men series from the 90s, same thing. X-Men was hardcore about racism. I mean, there was on the, and you have to understand, in the comics, this wasn't even that big of a thing. It wasn't that big of a thing. But the Friends of Humanity that was on the animated series in the 90s for the X-Men, that was something that was such a big element of that show that was such a small element of the cartoon or the comics. So, like, they amped up this, like, hyper-racist, clan-like, mutant-hating group to really delve down into like a racism mentality, like how to treat hyper racist like that. So I think it was very interesting, but like again, it was for kids. It was a kids cartoon series, and you had your, you know, bright outfits and all the kids friendly stuff, but at the same time, they were like real low key sneaking in these heavy lessons. And I think you lose that in modern cartooning. Courage the Cowardly Dog. I don't think I know that one. Courage the Cowardly Dog. He says, oh, do watch. When was it? 1999. I remember seeing promos for it. I don't think I ever watched it. It looks, at least based on the art style, it looks like it could be in the vein of Ren and Stimpy, which I'll be honest, I wasn't a big fan of. Granted, that was back then. I was, 14? The thing is that these kids' cartoons go on. Are supposed to be for kids, but are way more than that. The ones from the 90s, early 2000s, I absolutely agree. I think the problem is the modern ones have, they're intelligent, the humor, and so on. Yes, and I think, again, these early 2000s, late 90s cartoons, even early 90s cartoons, absolutely fit that mold, and they still did what these companies want them to do. The thing about the modern cartoons, I think they are 100% made to sell toys. I think the great thing that we got from the 90s and early 2000s is that those were shows that were done well, produced well, had really good stories, and also sold toys. Like, it wasn't just about selling toys. I think the problem is now in the modern day, and this, and everyone's guilty of this, it's not just like the kids cartoons that are on TV. You look at, they made an entire Batman movie, like animated movie series, just to sell toys, literally. I forget what it's called. I think it's called Batman Adventure or something like that. Batman Adventure. I don't know what it's called, but it's some weird. Let me see. Batman animated movie. Pull it up. Come on. Batman Unlimited. Batman Unlimited is 100% a toy selling. Yeah. It's just, it literally, he just shows up in different costumes constantly, which then just makes him be a toy selling thing. You have a joke from Dexter saying there's a printing on the mom's butt saying dad's a trophy. That's pretty adult. That's pretty adult. But can you see that as a kid, you might not think that. You might not think that that's that bad as a kid. So let me pull this up here. Boom. No, that's not. So yeah, this is the new Batman Unlimited series, and this is literally just to sell toys. The art is bad. I mean, the art is terrible. It's just, but look, here's one different suit. Here's the main suit. Here is, there's like a robot dog. There's another suit. Like, it's just toys. It's just toys. It's just, let's sell all these toys. Where, like, in the 90s, they sold a ton of toys, but they just did it based off the normal stuff. It was the comics and the cartoon series, but then they had, like, the thing I always remember is, Total Justice action figures. This was the stuff. This was based on like the comics / the TV shows, and he's with like these heavily armored Batman and Flash with mad armor, which I think is ironic because I think the new Flash in the movies has armor. Like, this was the kind of stuff they sold back then, based solely on the material that was out that was being done well. So it wasn't, let's make a whole series about making toys. It was, let's make a series that people will like, the kids will like. And I think that's the other problem is, because this is my problem. I realized like where the mentality was about 3-4 years ago. Ben 10, which I'll admit, I never really watched heavily, but I do appreciate. Ben 10 originally was basically this. Kid, freaking, you know, 10 different aliens he turns into. He grew up. He then had Ben 10 Ultimate Alien, had a bunch more aliens, bunch more toys, right? And then they were like, yo, we're gonna relaunch it. Why? Because kids buy toys. So we had to turn back to kids. We couldn't come up with something new. No, we have the mold still, or these are easy to make, or whatever stupid reason. Like, this looks like hot garbage to me. And that's the difference. I think that's the key difference, is something like Ben 10 I thought was brilliant, that it was growing with its audience. You could follow kids into teenagers and have them become fans of something more grown up, something more serious. But they were like, nah, we want kids to do it. Yeah, for sure. They sold a ton of Ben 10. I remember I used to work at a retailer here, and We always had Ben 10 displays. Always. And like, quite honestly, I would look at it and be like, well, that's kind of cool. Yeah, might pick one up. Like, and I'm an adult and I don't watch things. So, like, it bothers me. I mean, like, they even had a live-action version. Like, they had a live-action Ben 10. Apparently, they have a CG. Like, there's all these different things. But, and I think he's grown up again, because this is a new version of him being more grown up. Ben 10 Omniverse. I'm just saying. It's like, oh, this worked. Let's do it again. And I bet you any amount of money, they're going to do it again. 3-5 years from now, they're going to be like, all right, the audience has moved past the buying toys phase. Let's go ahead and reset and just do it again. We'll make another Ben 10 kids series. And the problem with that is it makes money, so why wouldn't you, right? I've met the guys behind the property. I've met, I think it's called Action Something Studio. Dang it, I can't think of it. Ben 10 Wikipedia, there we go. Man of Action Studio, Duncan Rouleau, Joe Casey, Joe Kelly, Steve Siegel. Those are all comic book writers. They're all, like, 3 out of the 4 of them are some of my favorite writers. So, like, I can't be mad at them. Like, it's hard for me to be mad at them. Like, hey, make that money, right? Yeah, this was 2016 was the reboot. Let's see. No pictures, really? Toys and merchandise. Look at that. Uh-huh. Video games. Live action game show. And it's just franchising and branching off the same thing. It's just trying to make money. And I can't be mad at nobody trying to make money. But it's just like, you look at that. So you look at Spider-Man, the animated series from the 90s. Boom. Look at that. Classic Spidey. Good art. You look at the next Spider-Man. Unlimited. Again. Very good. Good evolution. It had some really cool concepts. It brought in some other Marvel characters. And then it was, after that, I think it was Spectacular. And I won't lie, I was real mad about this show. I thought the art was super, like too angular, just not comic book enough. It just felt like real lazy comic, like real lazy art. Like, this was kind of one of the first things I saw. But I will tell you, the story writing in this series, incredible. I think this series to this day has the best Venom. Not the whole Venom story, but the moment where Peter Parker casts off the Venom suit, I think the best one is in this series. Then you look at, what was after Spectacular? Spider-Man. Animated Spider-Man. What was the other series? Ultimate Spider-Man was the new one. Can I restart the webcam thing? Is my webcam freezing up? It's delayed. How about now? Still. I'll unplug. Plug it back in. Boom. How about now? Then they did Ultimate Spider-Man. What? Why is it all expanded? I don't know. I'll adjust the window in OBS. Okay. Yeah, it must have been the way the way Caffeine interprets the OBS stream. Ultimate Spider-Man. Again, I think it went back to more of the better art roots, but then it brought in this element, the like little chibi angel and devil on the shoulder, little chibi asides, and I was like, But again, it at least did better art and better stories. The little asides was whatever. Marvel's Spider-Man is the new one. Marvel's Spider-Man, the animated series. Look, do you see the point of the head? It like this just jaggedy, like feel like it stabs someone with the face. But the biggest key that I want to bring up, there's not a single shadow on this dude. And not a single one. Same thing. The background has shadows, but that's because there's somebody else drawing the backgrounds. I was so I watched the moment where... Oh, interesting. See, like... But this is the kind of thing. Like, if this is on the show... I hate to say it, but I'm going to have to watch it. Because, like... Citizen V. But... Is this the Iron Man that's on that show? It's terrible. That's ugly. Come on. But I watched the moment. And here's... I think this is it. That was right after the moment. I watched the setup sequence... Where he got the powers, and this is right when he got bit, right? There's, again, no shadows. The only time you see the shadows, this is like a weird, like, front-facing, like, really kind of meant to give you some sort of emotional reaction. When he got bit, or when he opened the door and he saw the machine, like, radiating or whatever... I was like, oh, wow, why does this look so different? And then I realized it's because there's so much light from this machine that it was actually casting shadows. And they've not done that in the entire sequence prior to it. That I was like, what? And it made me realize how bad it was. Like, this whole scene, the best part about it is the thing that he's on. Like, it's so... I think this is where a lot of animation is going these days. There's an outstanding... What is the new Dragon Ball called? Dragon Ball Super. And there are... The show that airs versus what's on the DVDs... The show that airs is so badly done. There was a whole article done about this... Let's see. I think it was just anime broadcast versus DVD. No. No. They... Was it Osaka? Yeah. Something like this. Basically, it shows off, like, the original broadcast version and, like, how much more detail the DVD has. And you look at certain things and you're just kind of like... Wow, it's almost as if a different crew is working on it. Like, right here, this is a perfect example. TV broadcast. Like, this is not bad. But there's just so much more detail in the DVD version. the original article that I was thinking about is they had, Dragon Ball Super broadcast versus DVD. There we go. Here's the difference. Like, that's trash. Like, the difference... Look at that hand. That fist is terrible. I mean, like, that fist looks like I drew it. And then for the Blu-ray, you've got somebody that just, like, really clearly knows the material and knows how to draw. And I don't know what happens. I don't know, like, why that happens. There's really no reason. Oh, that's just a comparison of the old versus the new. I'm not gonna lie, both of these kind of suck. it's very, very interesting to me, like, how much they're willing to... Oh, this is the one. And I'm like, this can't be real. Like, the left one looks like some kid did it. But then when you pull up the actual video, it's ridiculous. I'll cut the audio.
What is going on, my super sandwiches? Ralph's not here, and today I want to do...
Like, so much less detail in the TV version. Like, so much less detail. Oh, I thought this guy was going to show the actual... Oh my god, that's terrible. Seriously, the one... Like, it's clearly a different studio doing it. Like, that's not even done by the same artist. It's so ridiculous. I hope this is the video. Oh, he shows the shots. Yeah, that's such a ridiculous... Like, this is a crazy difference. Wow. And it's laziness. It's laziness. It's the lack of a desire to produce something that's truly worthwhile. No, I just read it. It was what you were saying. Yeah, it's to speed up for release. But that's stupid. Who cares? Dragon Ball Super was so delayed. Like, Dragon Ball Super was so far behind the last series, who cares? You know what I'm saying? Like, it doesn't matter when you put it out. You could have made the whole series, or the whole first season, or whatever, and then, like, made it right and put it out. And then you don't have to do it twice. You literally don't have to do it twice. Because it just seems like they have two studios doing it. One really fast studio that's, like, just good enough, and then the good one. Because this can't be just, like, fixes. It looks like they've redone the entire sequence. And that's a lot of freaking work. It's not released for America first. Yeah, it's absolutely not released for America first. Yeah, it's just a Japanese series. It's just very interesting to me to see kind of how that works. All right, I think we're going to call it there. Blaster, you weren't there when I said this earlier. Later tonight, we're going to have... they release episodes in Japan Weekly, but they do that with TV shows here too, and cartoon series here too. It's just that they work ahead. So, like, it's like the same way TV series work, like live action works. They film months ahead. They have to. Otherwise, you're just... trying to crank out, you know, how many hours of filming and story and all this other stuff. That's another point, sell DVDs, yeah, but I feel like if it was just good to begin with, wouldn't you just want to own it? I don't know. I'm weird. I'm a weird mentality. I'm not buying DVDs anyway. So, like, that I'm not the target audience. So I don't know. As I was saying, you weren't here when I said this. Later today, I'm going to have a special bonus episode of Panels on Pages. I'm actually going to be talking with the creator of a book that I just finished reading from... I'll show you. Boom. Samurnauts. I just finished it. I picked it up at C2E2. It is fantastic. It's delicious. It's a great story. But anyway, I'm going to be speaking with one of the creators tonight, so make sure you're you're on tonight. Want to do that. That's going to be it for this episode. For those watching and listening in the future, thank you for hanging out. Thank you for listening and watching. Make sure you check out the live broadcast on Caffeine every Wednesday, usually between 10 and 11 a.m. Central Time, not counting the special broadcast. It's going to be a little bit later. Make sure you guys check us out on Twitter, Instagram, all that stuff. Make sure you subscribe to the main channel, youtube.com/T3G Media, and we'll see you in the next one.